Oh, come thou day spring, come and cheer our spirits by thine advent here. Disperse the gloomy clouds of night and death's dark shadows put to flight. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O
Hello, and a very warm welcome to a somewhat different carol service this year. I know many are really missing being able to go and sing a traditional carol service, and so we were keen to try and do what we could to provide at least a sense of sharing in a traditional carol service together. So it's my pleasure to welcome you to this, our online carol service, for the folk of Newcastle West Methodist Circuit, along with many new friends and old friends scattered about who are sharing with us too. You are all very welcome. So we have carols which we bring you from various churches in our circuit, and we have Bible readings too, which together remind us once again of Jesus, the true light of the world, coming to bring hope and light into a world of much lostness and uncertainty. Perhaps this year, more than ever, we need to rejoice in and celebrate the greatest story ever told, that God himself was born as a man and his name was Jesus. And he truly was and is the light that transforms us and shows us a new way of living. I want to thank all those who've been involved in putting this service together, readers and musicians and singers. Thanks to everyone who've made this possible. So let's relax, sit back, and enjoy what unfolds as we share in this time together, and as we celebrate the light that came into this world 2,000 years ago, but who still shines for us today, and his name is Jesus. We begin appropriately with the lighting of our Advent candles for this, the fourth Sunday in Advent. Enjoy the service.
We light the candles for hope, peace, and joy. Before I was born, the Lord called me. In the shadow of his hand, he hid me. We light this candle to remember God's love for the whole of creation. God loves us into being and enfolds us safely forever. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in him. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in her.
The promise. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness, from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
And now our prayers. Let us pray. Almighty Father, light and love, your radiance is such that angels even shield their faces. And yet you teach us to seek you, that your light may shine through us in the world of our day and the world of our night. We praise and thank you for such grace and mercy, but most of all, for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, the light of the world, whose radiance is eternal and never dimmed or overcome. We remember especially this night how that radiance shone forth from a stable in Bethlehem and brought great rejoicing, wonder, awe and celebration. For in the darkness, a boy was born for us. A son was given unto us to be our Saviour and our King. And we recall how angels sang for joy as the sky was lit at midnight and shepherds and wise men bowed down in homage to the Saviour of the world. O Lord Jesus, as we have all travelled through a time of unforeseen darkness this year, we thank you that tonight we have the opportunity to celebrate your coming to us. Not as a baby in a manger years ago in Bethlehem, but in every moment of our lives. Instill in us, we pray, therefore, a daily reminder that you are always with us, every step of the way, leading us ever onwards, guiding us as a living light upon our path and a lamp to guide our feet. Forgive us for those times when we have lost hold of your vision of your kingdom's way, when we have let despair overcome our faith and trust in you, when we have preferred darkness to light to hide our shame and our shortcomings. We confess that we are not the people we ought to be, and we have let you down by our unwillingness to shed the light of your love abroad in the world of our day. O living Lord, kindle the flame of love within us this Christmas, and help us to know deep down that our prayers of penitence ascend, where we find them surpassed by your unlimited grace, which covers all our sins and saves us from Satan's power. God with us, we worship you this night for the hope and assurance that you give to us through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom and with you and the Holy Spirit be all praise and honour, glory and might, world without end. Amen. The Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Silent night, holy night, sleep. The angel visits Mary. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favoured. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of a greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favour with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she, who was said to be unable to conceive, is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her.
The angel visits Joseph. This is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet: "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus.
Thank you. Bethlehem and birth. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room available for them.
The Word became flesh. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him.
Love was born at Christmas. Hello there. For a number of years, myself and two friends would go for a few days walking in Yorkshire. We'd stay in an old stone cottage built long before central heating existed. Because of this, to keep out the cold and keep the warmth in, the walls were thick and the windows small, which meant that not a lot of natural light made its way into the cottage. There were no street lights, which meant that at night, especially if there was heavy cloud cover, there was no natural light at all. I remember being startled awake one night by a sudden loud noise from the living room, which was underneath the room I was sleeping in. Awake, it was so dark that I can honestly say without exaggeration, I couldn't see the hand in front of my face. Heart racing, I thought I ought to investigate. So, stumbling in the dark, I made my way to the door, and after a few gasps of thin air, my hand found the handle. Not wanting to wake my friends, in case it was nothing, I turned right and I silently made my way down the steep, narrow staircase, using my hands to brace myself against the walls as I stepped cautiously down into absolute blackness. At the bottom of the stairs, I found the handle and realised that we'd left the door slightly ajar. So, reaching inside, I felt for the light switch. My heart racing, feeling fearful, slightly panicked, and definitely out of my comfort zone, I took a deep breath. I counted to three and simultaneously swung open the door and switched on the light. Only to see two mice, startled by my sudden appearance, disappearing into a small hole behind the fireplace. I also noticed that the poker and tongs for the fire, which we'd left resting against the fireplace, had fallen over. This had been the noise I had heard. Returning to bed, my heart rate soon returned to normal. I felt safe, reassured, comforted, and so I quickly fell asleep and into a deep, peaceful sleep. In that moment, it's amazing what a difference a little bit of light made, both to my understanding of the situation and in turn to how I felt, moving from fearful to comforted in a matter of minutes. In our very first reading, the prophet Isaiah said, "The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the deep darkness, a light has dawned." The people walking in darkness that he's talking about were his own people, the Israelites, who were exiled from the promised land. They suffered hardship and oppression, and many believed that God had abandoned them. This was their darkness. But in their darkness, there is a sense of hope, the hope of a coming light, because Isaiah goes on, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given." So here in Isaiah, this hope-bringing light, the one who would transform the darkness, was in fact a child, a boy who was to come. Skip forward half a millennium or so and we come to John's Gospel. Now, unlike Matthew and Luke, John doesn't include a traditional birth story. You see, John's less concerned with telling us the story and more concerned about telling us what the story means. And John sets the tone right at the beginning. "In the beginning was the Word," he writes, "and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." In other words, before all things, there was a presence, an essence, a being that John calls the Word. And this Word was both separate from God and yet part of God. And John goes on to say that the Word became flesh In other words, this eternal God presence became human and lived among us. John also tells us that in this person was life, and that that life was the light of all people. So we see how Isaiah's promise of a hope-bringing light coming into the world is picked up by John, who goes on to reveal that this eternal God presence made human, in whom was the light of all people, is in fact the person whose birth we are remembering today. He was talking, of course, about Jesus. In fact, in chapter 8 of John's story of Jesus, he records Jesus saying, "I am the light of the world." It's quite a declaration, isn't it? Quite a statement. John is telling us that Jesus is the hope bringer and the one who can transform darkness. 2020's been a tough year, hasn't it? Who could have predicted this time last year what the last 12 months would hold? And let's be honest, many people have suffered. Some more than others. Some for short periods of time, some for longer. But many, if not all of us, had suffered or felt darkness at some point over the last 12 months. The effects of lockdown and isolation have affected people's mental, physical, emotional and spiritual well-being. We're just not meant to live like this. We are social beings after all. Over the months, as I've spoken to people, I've heard words like heaviness, dark clouds, deep sadness, unexplained anxiety, loss, grief, and fearful, used to explain the experience and emotional turmoil of what we've been living through. Perhaps you can relate to that. You could call it a kind of darkness. And people have also spoken of an absence, of lacking human contact, familiar routines, embracing a loved one, sharing a coffee, and at times just lacking hope. But here's the good news. Christmas is a season of hope, for we celebrate the coming of that light of all people. We celebrate the coming of the light of the world. Just as by switching on the light all those years ago, my discomfort, anxiety, and fear were transformed into reassurance, comfort, and peace. So by the Spirit of Jesus, we can experience the same today, whatever darkness we're living in. Please don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying trust Jesus and all your problems will disappear. What I am saying is that when we let the light of Jesus into our lives, then we start to see things differently. And as we see things in a different light, so our experience and emotional response will be different. The darkness of fear, the darkness of anxiety, the darkness of insecurity can be transformed into the light of reassurance or peace as we experience the deep hope that the light of Jesus can bring. And the best thing about it is, as John says, the darkness has not overcome the light. So the light of Jesus will never be overcome or diminished. It will never go out. It is always shining. It is always available. To know its work in our lives, we simply need to seek it, accept it, and trust it. The light shone then, and it shines today, always. Seek it, accept it, trust it. and you too will find. Your darkness can be transformed. So whatever darkness you're living through or might come your way, may you know the light of Jesus and its ability to transform your understanding, experience and life with hope, with comfort and with deep peace. May you know the light shining even in the darkest situation. The God of hope has come into the world and is always with us. Amen.
Visit of the shepherds. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Saviour has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favour rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
Thank you. The visit of the Magi. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem, in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother, Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
For our prayers of intercession tonight, there is a response. When I say the words, "The angel said," I invite you to respond, "Don't be afraid, I'm bringing you good news that is for everyone." And the words will be on the screen. So let's pray. The angel said, "Don't be afraid, I'm bringing you good news that is for everyone." Christmas doesn't feel much like good news, for those whose income has fallen this year because of redundancy, unemployment, or benefit reductions. Jesus, bringer of hope and light, help us to give gifts that cost love instead of money, not to fear the rising costs of Christmas or go into debt to pay for it. For all of us who are hard up, may the angel's message be good news. The angel said, "Don't be afraid. I am bringing you good news that is for everyone." Christmas doesn't feel much like good news for those who are homeless or lonely, if we don't have a warm place to be or a warm welcome from those we love. Jesus, bringer of hope and light, we may not be able to open up our homes at this time, but help us to open our hearts to those who are homeless and lonely, so that the angel's message may truly be good news for them. The angel said, "Don't be afraid. I'm bringing you good news that is for everyone." Christmas doesn't feel much like good news for those who have left their homes, communities, towns and countries this year, fleeing from violence, war or terror. Christmas doesn't feel much like good news if you live in a tent, out in the open air, and it will simply be a day of struggle like any other. Jesus, light of the world, bring hope into the uncertainty of life as a refugee. Help those of us who live secure lives to give what we can to those who are left, have left everything behind, so that the angel's message may be good news for those who are refugees. The angel said, "Don't be afraid. I'm bringing you good news that is for everyone." Christmas doesn't feel much like good news for those who are ill or suffering. Thank you, Lord, for the dedication and care of medical and care staff, many of whom will be at work even on Christmas Day. We know that our earthly bodies won't last forever, but we also know that you are the God of the impossible and still working miracles today. Please bring healing by medicine or miracle, so that the angel's message may be good news for those who are sick or suffering. The angel said, "Don't be afraid. I'm bringing you good news that is for everyone." If Christmas is to be good news for each of us here listening today, we need you, God, to meet us in Jesus Christ. We need you to offer us freedom, new hope and healing. We need to see our community transformed by this good news. Help us not to do away with the manger this Christmas, but to meet the Christ child afresh and discover what the good news of his birth means for our lives. We ask all our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, light of the world. Amen.
Oh, Tomorrow evening, God sends us a blessing in the sky. For the first time in 800 years, the planets of Saturn and Jupiter will align and form what scientists are calling the Christmas star. A blessing from heaven, marking Emmanuel, God with us. At the end of a year where hope is coming not just from a vaccine, but also from God in the heavens. As Charles Wesley said at the end of that wonderful hymn, when he celebrated Jesus with us, bringing life and light and hope and love. So friends, have a joyous Christmas. We wish you all the best for 2021. Enjoy tomorrow's phenomenon. Only happens every 800 years, and we're living to see a sign from our wonderful, precious Lord. God bless you all, and stay safe.
What child is this who laid to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch are keeping? This is Christ the King, whom shepherds God and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary. So bring him incense, gold and myrrh, come peasant king, to mourn him the King.